My name is Dan Corden. I'm running for re-election in the New York State Assembly 73rd Assembly District. In the wake of the COVID-19 pandemic, we need a tested and experienced leader in Albany who gets things done. During this crisis, I've been working tirelessly to ensure my constituents have what they need. I have helped dozens of Eastsiders secure their unemployment claims after the Department of Labor failed them. I have helped organize free rides for seniors in need, distributed face masks in the district, and worked with many small businesses to ensure that they can access city, state, and federal funding. I am the son of two public school teachers and parent of two public school students. I know how important it is to make Eastside Public Schools remain some of the very best in the city. I've worked to bring more pre-K seats to the East Side. I've opened PS 527 in Yorkville East Middle School. I've helped fund our PTAs. I've worked closely with Hunter College to ensure that we have excellent education options from pre-K through graduate school. As a transit rider, I know that our transit system is the engine that powers New York City. When progress stalled on the Second Avenue subway, I helped secure $1 billion in funding to help reset construction and get the project done. When I found out the East Side had some of the worst air quality in New York City, caused by old boilers burning dirty fuel and sending dangerous pollutants into the air, I set up a fund to help residential building owners upgrade to cleaner fuel. For 3 years, I have received a 100% rating from the New York League of Conservation Voters for my commitment to environmental protection and climate action. I am the only actual pro-choice candidate in this race. I've worked to protect reproductive rights for years, which is why I was endorsed by Planned Parenthood. If given the opportunity to represent you once again, I will advocate for public hearings into the failure of the state's unemployment insurance system. I will fight to expand early voting, bring automatic voting registration to a vote in Albany, and support a constitutional amendment to allow people to vote by mail. Further, with so many of our local businesses suffering, I will work to expand access to government funding at every level for small businesses on the East Side and in Midtown Manhattan. I've spent a lifetime serving my community. As a pro bono attorney, I hosted legal clinics for tenants facing eviction. As a community board 8 member, I chaired the transportation committee. And as your assembly member, I fight for you every day. I hope you'll join Congress member Carolyn Maloney, New York City Comptroller Scott Stringer, Manhattan Borough President Gail Brewer, Council Members Ben Kalos and Keith Powers, and State Senator Liz Krueger in supporting my re-election campaign. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Cameron Kaufman, and I'm running for New York State Assembly here on Manhattan's East Side. I'm a lifelong resident of this community, and I'm running on a platform of full-time representation, ethics reform, and helping our small businesses. I hope to earn your vote. If elected, I would be the youngest New York State Assemblyman since Teddy Roosevelt. I decided to run for office because I know that there's no time to waste on 21st century issues like climate change, education reform, or gun control. My generation is just getting started in government and public service. But we know that we need clean government now. As we live through this COVID-19 pandemic, full-time representation is more important now than ever. We need lawmakers who can listen to the concerns of residents and develop viable policy solutions. Rebuilding our city and state won't be easy, but we can do it by working together, because now is not the time to give up on this amazing city. We must fight together in our recovery efforts. I'm proud to have run a campaign where we've talked to thousands of residents and heard their concerns and what the New York State government can do to help them. We put forth plans to help small businesses recover, to help individuals who lost their jobs to recover, to use the pandemic to build on progress we've made fighting climate change. I'm also excited about our plans for ethics reform, to cap outside income for state legislators, and work to fight corruption in Albany. It would be an honor to serve the neighborhood I've lived in my entire life in the New York State Assembly. I'm ready to get to work to help our city rebuild, to provide aid for those who need it, and begin cleaning up Albany. Thank you.
Welcome to Represent NYC election coverage brought to you by Manhattan Neighborhood Network in partnership with the League of Women Voters of New York State and Gotham Gazette. I'm Ben Max, executive editor of Gotham Gazette. We're pleased to bring you interviews with the two candidates in the Democratic primary in the 73rd Assembly District in Manhattan. The primary is happening this month of June, with early voting underway from June 13th through June 21st and primary day June 23rd. All eligible Democrats can vote in this primary and many others across the city for state legislature, Congress, and more, and there are a small number of primaries in other parties. Also, because of the coronavirus pandemic, the governor issued an order allowing all eligible voters to vote by absentee ballot in this month's primaries, so take advantage of that if you prefer. The 73rd Assembly District includes parts or all of Manhattan neighborhoods, including the Upper East Side, Midtown East, Turtle Bay, and Sutton Place. It's one of 150 assembly seats across the state, each representing well over 100,000 constituents, and the assembly is the lower house of the state's two-house legislature, which also includes the state senate. All 213 seats in the legislature are on the ballot every 2 years, so here we are with this year's elections. There are two candidates seeking your vote in the 73rd Assembly District Democratic primary, and we're interviewing them separately today over Zoom. Joining me now is incumbent Democratic Assemblymember Dan Court. Thank you for being here, Assemblymember.
Thank you for having me, Ben.
So I'll just ask you a few questions in the time we have together, and then towards the end, go towards a little bit more of a lightning round style, yes, no, short answer, just for a few other topics that we want to give a chance for voters to hear where you stand. And then a 1 minute closing statement where you get to address voters directly with your pitch for reelection here. So let's get started. So you want another term. Give us the highlights of what you have accomplished during this term that's almost over.
Well, this term I've had 6 pieces of legislation passed, 5 signed by the governor. The governor signed a bill of mine last year, and it runs the gambit of work on behalf of my constituents, from the synchronization of pharmaceutical prescriptions, allowing my senior population to get all of their prescriptions in one interval, or eliminating prior authorization for those who are seeking treatment for opioid, being the lead sponsor and the author of the bill, providing a co-op, a condominium tax abatement, and my leadership on the MTA's capital fund, dedicated sources of revenue to ensure track and signal work on the Lexington line, as well as my leadership on Albany, both individually and beyond, on legislation significant to the city at this particular time, on reforming our criminal legal system, as well as oversight of the NYPD and other state law enforcement across the state. So I run on my record for reelection, and most recently, all of this legislation that I have passed, working extremely hard for my constituents.
So as you sort of indicated a little bit there, you know, legislators, of course, have their own pieces of legislation that they put forward. But then, you know, there's also a lot of legislation that sort of happens when the majority conference kind of gets together and establishes its priorities. And a lot of what happens in Albany especially happens in the state budget. Talk a little bit about what were 2 or 3 things where maybe it wasn't exactly your piece of legislation, but you were most vocal in the assembly majority where you were saying this needs to be a major priority for my constituents and thus for the majority.
2 issues, transportation and criminal justice reform. Criminal justice reform, both because of my deep interest on issues of justice and being a criminal defense attorney, knowing firsthand the inequities in our legal system. I fought very hard for reforming our bail system, which was passed through the budget, and then opposed those efforts, unfortunately, which passed in April, rolling back some of the progress. So those were budget items, but I was very vocal and in a leadership position in my house in the assembly on making sure we had a fair and just criminal legal system, specifically to bail and discovery reform the last 2 years. On transportation, just briefly, the MTA capital plan is the lifeline for my constituents, and the Lexington line is significant in light of the overcrowding. We've had success, and I'm proud of my work, even before I was in the legislature, pushing for the Second Avenue subway and dedicated sources of revenue needed for continued construction. But most significantly, the pots of money that I was able to secure working with others through the budget will go to critically needed signal upgrades on the Lexington line. which is a direct benefit to my constituents.
And part of what's supposed to fund some of that is congestion pricing. Can you give us an update on where that stands and what you're doing to try to make sure that it actually happens?
Well, that it in the current budget, we had to make certain decisions on funding the MTA because of the pandemic and the deprivation of resources to the MTA. The fare box rate recovery was lower. Less usage means less money to the MTA. So the capital program, we hope to be implemented through the commission that will look at congestion pricing. We passed essentially the enabling legislation in Albany to allow that to happen. And I'll be pushing at the city level for that to proceed because that is needed infrastructure money. And the revenue from the congestion pricing will go to all sorts of capital projects, not least of which is continued track and signal work on the Lexington line.
So we're obviously, there's so much focus right now on the COVID-19 crisis, as much as there's been a lot of progress after a really terrible time on the public health side and things look like they've turned a corner there. There's obviously also the social economic devastation that has occurred. Can you speak a little bit as to your priorities for trying to ensure the recovery in your district around things like employment, small businesses, and anything else you want to put into the category of recovery from this crisis?
Yes, and this is the singular issue of focus for myself and my constituents going forward. We'll start with the work that myself and my office has been deeply involved in, and that's the Department of Labor and ensuring that individuals receive their unemployment benefits. The startups to receiving money was less than perfect, and I'll use my oversight responsibilities in the legislature to make sure the Department of Labor is doing its job and that the technology systems are upgraded. But that is the single most important thing my office has been involved in making sure that people who find themselves unemployed through no fault of their own, through circumstances beyond their control, are able to receive their unemployment benefits. Because if they don't, all sorts of worsening occurrences of their situation and others will happen. Secondly, it's helping small businesses and working with partners in Washington, Congresswoman Maloney, who and I work very closely together, to make sure the next rounds of stimulus money include money, hopefully, for state programs that go to provide benefits to renters, small businesses especially, who are hurting. And whether they live in my district or just work in my district, small businesses being the lifeline of this city, we have to use existing state programs through federal stimulus money to help those small business owners. So those are two of many of the things I'm involved in.
There's been some debate at the state level, as obviously I'm sure you know, around whether the state could do more for both small businesses and for renters. There's been some relief passed at the state level, but the governor has mostly said we just don't have the money to do more, and it really needs to come from the federal government. Where do you stand on some of that discussion in terms of whether the state could do more for small businesses and for both commercial and residential renters? And the fact that would, you know, as most people argue for it, say it would have to come with higher tax revenue to make it happen.
Yes, absent a larger, more flexible federal stimulus package, the state will face very difficult choices. I think the only way to resolve this is through revenue enhancements, and that's looking at Albany, whether a graduated income tax return, which the income tax increase, which the assembly has passed many times, as well as looking at other possible one-shot revenue resources, because it's time to make difficult decisions. And absent large amounts of federal stimulus money coming in the next 3-6 months, I think state government will be forced to make some really difficult choices. And I'm on record as supporting the increase in revenue to achieve those policy goals.
And about where in the income scale should those increases start? I mean, I don't know if there's been any different discussion now that we're in this crisis. You know, it's very different, obviously, for the assembly to pass things prior to the crisis, to pass things when there's a Republican state Senate. But where does that stand, at least, or in your perspective, at least?
Well, look, as you know, Ben, even with revenue enhancements, we may not see any of that income till the fourth quarter of this year, or more likely the next year. So, The scope of, as it occurs in Albany, the scope of the actual percentages of increase and how the groupings go will be a matter for debates. I have been honest about that under difficult circumstances, I would need to look at some of my constituents and say, this is necessary for the salvation of the city of New York. It may not be something we want to do, but it may be something we need to do. The specific parameters of that would be the subject of negotiations in Albany.
So let's get to a couple criticisms that your challenger is raising. Have a Democratic primary. Obviously, that's part of the reason why we're chatting here. You're hoping to prevail this month in that primary. Two things for you to respond to. One is criticism raised around you earning outside income from your legislative job. How do you respond to questions raised about why you're bringing in outside income? And two, we'll get to in a minute, but why don't we start with the outside income? Two is the fact that you're running for Manhattan District Attorney in next year's election, and why not sort of forego election to the state legislature to focus on that race? If you were to be successful in that race, you would be then stepping down right after. So why don't you start with outside income? Go ahead.
I mean, that's laughable that my challenger, Mr. Kaufman, is attacking me for outside income. Cameron Kaufman's whole life is outside income. This is a 23-year-old opponent who's never had a job in his life, had his whole way paid through college with no college loans, whose own court filing shows that he lives off a trust fund or his parents' largesse, whose parents have basically handed him $500,000 to challenge me for office with no actual experience. Everything about Cameron Kaufman's life is outside income and other people's money spent on his behalf. To the specific criticism, I have been very public that I support a full-time legislature in the complete elimination of outside income through a constitutional procedure. But I am a middle-class person. I have two kids and family obligations. And representing and living in one of the wealthiest districts in the country, certainly in this state, and that's why I practice law and need to living on the Upper East Side of Manhattan.
And of course, if an outside income restriction is passed, that would mean going forward with a significant raise for legislators, correct?
That would be the fair outcome.
Right. And so on the campaign, so you're running for Manhattan District Attorney in next year's election. You're asking your constituents right now to send you back to Albany. If reelected this year, you'll spend a very significant amount of time next year running for District Attorney. And then if you win, leaving this office. So can you square that for us?
Yes. Well, one, I announced publicly in September of last year that I would challenge Cy Vance for District Attorney in Manhattan because of my deep dissatisfaction with how he's run the office. But I was transparent about my future intentions to run, not this year, but next year, because I thought that was in my contract with my constituents. That's information they deserve to know. And that's why I was very public about it. I wasn't cute about it. I didn't say I was thinking about it. I wanted to be honest and was honest with my constituents. Secondly, the idea that running for district attorney would take away focus from my job for my constituents is absurd. Look at last year, 2019, last year, when I announced publicly I was running for district attorney. I passed five major pieces of legislation. During this cycle, I've passed six pieces of legislation, the last signed by the governor. I have basically a 100% voting record and involved deeply in oversight hearings, both on the Corporations Committee, Judiciary Committee, over the MTA and others. So there's really no evidence to suggest in any way whatsoever that my attention is anything but on my constituents.
Well, neither last year nor this year is obviously the campaign year. So is there something you can, I know promises and guarantees are easy to come by in politics and then be reversed, but is there anything you can sort of promise constituents about your voting record next year, your attendance in hearings, you know, that there wouldn't be a drop off in those?
No, there won't be a drop off. And most of my constituents can look at 9 years. And I know, Ben, you're asking about prospectively, not retroactively. But the best indicator of future conduct is how you've comported yourself as an elected official. And for 9 years, I've taken my job very seriously. And not just legislation, but to your point, involved in the budget process, involved in oversight hearings, specifically with the MTA and holding them accountable and making sure there was a better product. And that's how you get track and signal work on the Lexington line. It wasn't all my doing, but my constituents can expect going forward the same level of service from me and attention by me that they've received for the last 9 years.
So in our, I'm glad we've got you pledging no drop off in your voting record and attendance in Albany next year if reelected. Couple of quick questions, very short answer, and then we'll give you 1 minute closing here in our short time together. Can you name one piece of legislation that's at the top of your agenda that hasn't been passed that you want to see passed either this year or next year in the state?
Yes, it's a new piece of legislation by myself. It was just authored and issued with Senator Myrie. It's about reverse search warrants. And I think when we passed significant reform, police reform legislation in Albany 2 weeks ago, a lot of us, and myself included, said this is the beginning of a process, not the end of a process. And this was a specific example of the way District Attorney Vance has used search warrants to invade the privacy of my constituents, and I think unconstitutionally, according to the Fourth Amendment.
Just one other quick one, and then we'll go to a closing. There's plenty more to discuss there, but unfortunately, out of the time. Are you continue to be in support of the New York Health Act for single payer in New York State?
I am.
You are. Okay. So a bunch of other things I won't get to here, but we had a good discussion. Why don't you take a minute, and then I'll say goodbye to the audience, but why don't you take a minute to talk directly to voters about your pitch for reelection?
Thank you, Ben, and thank you to the staff for doing this questionnaire and candidate questionnaire. For 9 years, I've had an incredible opportunity to represent 129,500 people, and I've gotten to know so many individually. But this is a very different time for my constituents in New York City. If you're a public school parent like I am, you worry about what September happened for return of our children to our public schools and how that's going to work. If you're a small business owner, or whether you live or work in this district, you're worried about how you're going to make payroll and go on. This is not the time for untested leadership in Albany or any level of government. This is a time that my constituents need somebody who has a track record of success, who has a track record of attention to the details, and I'm proud of that. And that's the work I've been doing on your behalf for the last 9 years, and I ask for your support again, as I want to serve you in Albany.
Thank you, Assemblymember Court. Appreciate the time. Look forward to talking more at another juncture. Joining me now is the challenger, Cameron Kaufman, who is attempting to unseat Assemblymember Dan Court. Thank you for being here, Cameron.
Well, thank you so much, Ben. Thank you to MNN. Thank you to the League of Women Voters. I appreciate having this opportunity. And I know it's obviously a bit of a weird election cycle, given that so many people will be voting by mail. Many people have probably already cast their ballots or might have voted early at one of the three sites that's for our district. But nonetheless, for those that have still not made their decisions yet, I'm excited to talk about my policies, my campaign, and my vision.
Absolutely. So I'll have a few questions for you, then maybe a lightning round of some quicker yes, no, short answer types, and then we'll give you a minute closing statements. It's going to be a fairly short conversation, but I'm glad we're having it. As you said, it gives voters a chance to hear more from you and see you answer some questions. So why don't we jump right in? You're seeking to become a member of the State Assembly. A key piece of your campaign obviously has been the fact that you're trying to unseat an incumbent. But about you, before we get to your case against the incumbent, what qualifies you to jump to the State Assembly? What have you done in the district that makes you prepared and deserving of being elected to the State Assembly?
Yeah, so I'm a lifelong resident of the district, very active and involved in this community, being brought up here on the Upper East Side. I grew up in Carnegie Hill, now live in Lenox Hill. And it's a community that's very special to me. I have a lot of ties to community groups. My Temple Emmanuel, I'm very involved in with Community Action, as well as with All Souls Church and their soup kitchen. I think what's important about this race, though, and what's important about state and local government in general, is that we need people who are willing to listen. And I think that I've been doing that for my entire life, being a part of this community, being a listener. And that's really been the major theme of this campaign, going to every single community board meeting, NYPD community council precinct meetings, going to town halls, trying to really talk to as many people as possible. We've been out on the streets, obviously been a little different the past couple months given the pandemic, but I can talk more about actually how we continue to reach voters through that. Another thing that I will say, I understand if people might be concerned at the fact that I am 23 years old, and that's obviously I'd be the youngest assembly member, and there's debate about whether it's since Teddy Roosevelt or since Dick Godfrey, but whatever the case, it's the youngest in a while. And the fact of the matter is, though, that the campaign has shown itself to be a very professional and very in the community in terms of, if you look at the last few months, no one really would have been able to respond to this pandemic, but I am proud of what myself and my team have done, you know, in setting up mutual aid. We've given out now 3,000 bottles of sanitizer, 3,000 masks, been everywhere around the district doing that, setting up canned food drives. So I do think that if people want to know what experience we have and kind of what I will look like as an assembly member, you can look to what we've been doing over the past couple months as evidence of that.
And do you understand if there's voters in the district who say, I, other than when you jumped into this campaign, I don't really know you very well. I don't really know your track record in the district. I feel a little hesitant giving you my vote, as opposed to someone who's, you know, been in office quite a while, you know, has been serving the district a long time. Do you get that skepticism, or how do you overcome that?
Yeah, I totally understand the feeling. I mean, I would say that I do know a ton of people in this district. I said, lived here my entire life. I grew up here and have been very involved in the community. And I'm proud, you know, if you look at the hundreds of people who have donated from in district to this campaign, shows the connection that we do have to this district. And I think that the events of the past couple months have demonstrated that we need some change. We need new leadership, because in many ways we do face a blank slate, a tabula rasa, in the way that a lot of our preconceived notions about the way that anything works, whether it's our city's transportation system, whether it's just how people go to work, whether it's our education system, a lot of those preconceived notions have been thrown out the window, I think. And so I think bringing in new people who have a different perspective from my generation will be beneficial to that.
So so let's jump into that. I want to come back to your case against the incumbent in a few minutes, but let's jump into that then. You have this blank slate that you're saying in terms of a lot of need to start over, reinvent things. What is that pitch? What is your vision? What would you try to make sure is part of that reinvention if you're elected?
Yeah, so I think that there's a lot of things. I would start with small businesses, which has been a major focus of this campaign. The retail vacancy rate was already very bad in our neighborhood before all this happened, at about 1 in 7 storefronts. I would think it's probably about 1 in 3 now. We obviously don't know, and you know, we're going to wait for the next kind of couple months to see that plan out. But this is really a major issue, something that's brought up in the community all the time. I think that we need to work with the city council to be aggressive in ways that we can get these small businesses back on their feet. So repurposing parking spots into sidewalk cafe seating, as they've done in other cities, making it easier to get a sidewalk cafe, working, you know, the commercial rent tax, I see what place it serves, but I don't think that we should be punishing businesses right now, making it hard to set up. I think the state can look at business interruption insurance. You have companies that got business interruption insurance policies, and that was for some sort of loss of business that they couldn't control. So maybe a flood or whatever. But I would think a pandemic would be the exact thing that a business interruption is, that you have no control over. The state telling you have to shut down because people's lives are at risk, and yet the insurance companies aren't paying out these policies. So there's ways to go and have a massive overhaul on the small business front. And as somebody, we have a storefront office. We're on 57th and 1st. I think that's great to be an assembly campaign with a storefront office. But we talked to 15, 20 landlords about their spaces, about trying to find one. The fact that we got a deal is indicative of just how weak the market is right now. But we got to talk to so many people and say, has anybody been interested in your space in the past year, in the past 2 years? And the answer from the majority of people was no. So I think it's really an issue of demand. And I think that we need to work with people like Andrew Rigi from the Hospitality Alliance to really come up with ways to make it easier to start up a business. And whether it's loans, whether it's also looking at the tax burdens, and then looking at the spaces, as I said, the parking spaces, the sidewalk cafes, we can do that.
So let's hear a couple other top priorities. You go to Albany in the state assembly after being elected. What's the top of your list in terms of how you're trying to shape policy that comes out of state government, other than small businesses? What are a couple other specific policies?
Well, I would say our other two major things are climate change and ethics reform. So on ethics reform, I think that one thing that we have noticed in talking to thousands of people in the district, that they're not too happy that the incumbent assembly member takes outside income. He takes about $125,000 as a lawyer representing insurance companies. And I do think that creates, first of all, a conflict of interest. And some insurance companies do contribute to his campaign finance account. And you know, you had issues with Sheldon Silver and Dean Skelos. There's been a lot of questions about outside income in New York State. And the lawmakers, almost half of them do it. I think that that's something you could do as Congress, cap 15%. You can also work to replace J-COPE with an actually independent ethics authority, Liz Krueger, my state senator, who I really admire. I think she's tremendous, has been advocating for that, and that's a way to go about it. But I think that people really need to believe in state government again. because we did see so much, and I'll give credit to the incumbent assembly member and to the entire legislature. I think in 2019, a lot of great legislation was passed in having a Democratic legislature and governor for the first time in 50 or so years. And they passed tremendous things like the Reproductive Health Act and CLCPA. And so I think that's great, but I still think that there's an aversion that people don't think that Albany is fighting for them, that it's broken. So ethics reform and actual real campaign finance reform, and I wouldn't call what just happened real campaign finance reform. I think something more on the scale of what New York City has would be better than that.
So you bring up in the campaign the assembly member's outside income. He points to your lack of, you know, roots or work in the district. He points to ties, your ties to real estate. You know, those are the sort of the big criticism lob back and forth. How do you respond to, you know, when the assembly member brings up your ties to real estate and questions whether, you know, as an assembly member, that would be where your interest lies?
Well, first of all, because you did bring up my roots to the district, I want to make it very clear that the assembly member claimed that I was not a New York resident. He made this claim. He tried to sue me off the ballot for voting while I was in college. I voted on campus. And the first department said in a 4-1 decision that I was indeed a resident, and noting all of my ties to this community. And if you can watch the oral argument, in fact, one of the key pieces of evidence that I interviewed, State Senator Liz Krueger on my campus radio show program, talking about the 2017 Constitutional Convention referendum, something that I thought was a good idea and something that Senator Krueger supported as well.
Right. So, so that established on the criticism, right. The main criticism. Yeah.
Yeah. On the real estate front, I would like to acknowledge that REBNY, the Real Estate Board of New York, is supporting one of the two candidates in this race. And that candidate is not me. That RPAC is supporting one of the two candidates in this race. That candidate is not me. I would also like to acknowledge, if you look at the Schedule C contributions, from partnerships, there are about 5 or 6 real estate partnerships on the incumbent's 32-day pre-primary. There are 0 on mine, and that on Friday, or I guess tomorrow, some people are watching this on Thursday, the incumbent will be speaking to REBNY. Will be speaking to REBNY members.
But what about your philosophy on development? Can you give us a little bit of just a general stance, you know, just in your district, not even more broadly than that, what your kind of lens on development, building bigger, rezoning, you know, whatever it might be, you know, what kind of viewpoint you would bring to the assembly on development?
Yeah, no, I mean,
obviously a major concern in the district, whether there's people who want more development or less, or, you know, downzoning, upzoning, but what's your particular lens?
No, overdevelopment is a major concern in our district. And, you know, we opened up our office on 57th and 1st. There's the massive tower on 58th Street that's about 90 stories high, casting shadows, causing health risk with the construction and really obstructing a lot of people in their day-to-day life with the noise. And this is all for a luxury tower. So I'm all in favor of development. I think that we do need to be looking at height, and that's something that's coming up as a city issue, obviously, for 3rd Avenue, 2nd Avenue, 1st Avenue, and York Avenue to install a 210-foot limit as we have in the avenues in the western part of the Upper East Side. And that is something that I would support. But I do think that more importantly, when we're developing, you know, our neighborhood has a total lack of affordable housing. In our neighborhood, almost all new developments are luxury developments. And I don't think that that's the direction that we should be going in right now. Especially if you look at where this city is right now, I don't think we need to be building more pied-à-terres and second apartments for people. I think we need to be building good middle-class housing.
All right, few more things in our limited time, and I appreciate those answers. Can you name any votes that Assemblymember Cord has taken that you would have taken differently in the last couple of years?
Well, I would have voted yes on the budget this year.
Mm-hmm. That's a big one?
That's a big one. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't necessarily say it's his votes. Congestion pricing obviously was tied into the budget. So I would never have co-sponsored and never would have been so in support of it as he is. And in fact,
you're opposed to congestion pricing, right?
I'm opposed to the current scheme. I think congestion pricing is a very important idea. As someone who cares about both the environment and cares about, I've noticed the congestion, but drawing this line on 60th Street and then coming up with a way to credit the tolls back to people who are commuting in, but then actually hitting people who live in the 50s and 60s makes no sense to me. The traffic is not caused from people that go from 70th Street to a doctor's appointment at NYU.
A couple quick things and then a 1-minute pitch from you to voters. Do you agree or disagree with the police reform bills that have recently been passed and signed into law this last week or two?
I agree with them. I think more needs to be done.
Okay. Are you in favor or opposed to calls to increase taxes on some higher earners?
In favor.
In favor. And do you have a income threshold where you think increases should start?
I think probably about 500,000. Okay. But I know that's going to be quite a debate with the governor and everybody. So,
do you support the New York Health Act for single payer healthcare in New York?
I don't. I think we need healthcare reform, but I don't think that's the way to do it.
Do you support the legalization of adult use of marijuana?
If the funding actually goes to underserved communities that were hit really hard by the war on drugs, yes.
Okay. And let's give you a minute to speak straight to voters here as part of this program. I appreciate the back and forth we've had. Obviously, it would be great to have more time or even a debate with the assembly member. But why don't you take a minute with a closing statement, and then I'll say goodbye.
All right. Well, I do want to say that in the past few months, meeting thousands of people, I think the stakes of this election are so big. We're coming off of a pandemic, and we're coming in an era of social change right now. I've seen my generation and many other generations, we've taken to the streets and we've demanded change. And as someone who has lived here my entire life and has roots in this community and has talked to many more voters than the incumbent assembly member has been out, I think that we need someone new who wants to serve full-time, who's not campaigning for district attorney at the exact same time, campaigning for higher office, someone who's put forth policy plans, about 75 policy bullet points on our website, someone who really cares about this community deeply and wants to do everything that they can to make it a better place. The stakes are really too high to go for the same old in Albany and to go for someone who is corrupt enough to try and sue me off the ballot during a pandemic, someone who's taking outside income, someone who, as I said, is running for another office at the exact same time. I'm really proud of my track record. I'm really proud of the work that I've done in this community. And I hope that people will take a chance on me in the next 6 days and my vision for how we can rebuild after COVID-19.
Thank you, Cameron Kaufman. I appreciate it. Appreciate the time. A reminder to voters, Democrats in this 73rd Assembly District on Manhattan's East Side can participate in this primary. And there are primaries happening all over Manhattan and the city where eligible voters in the relevant political party can participate, including for many other seats in the state legislature, the Assembly and the Senate, and the U.S. House of Representatives, among others. All eligible voters can participate in early voting, which is ongoing through June 21st, or vote at your poll site on primary day, Tuesday, June 23rd, or you can choose to vote by absentee ballot, which everyone is allowed to do this June. Please do vote if you're eligible. And thank you for watching Represent NYC election coverage on Manhattan Neighborhood Network. I'm Ben Max from Gotham Gazette. Goodbye.